Hi, we are continuing with the introduction to neuroanatomy based on the development. In the initial chalkboard diagram, you have already learned that at 3 weeks, you have three primary brain vesicles, and they are consecutively termed as prosencephalon, midbrain mesencephalon, and the hindbrain, which is rhombencephalon. And they evolve at 5 weeks into secondary brain vesicles, which are the two telencephalic vesicles and the midline diencephalon. The mesencephalon remains like that, and the rhombencephalon, or the hindbrain, develops into a metencephalon and a myelencephalon. We have already completed this part, but we have to see this more than this two-dimensional diagrams. We have to see this in a 3D perspective. In a lateral view, the three vesicle stage is actually like this. So what you see here is the spinal cord, which was remaining on the caudal aspect, if you remember the previous picture. So from that spinal cord, the brain bends on itself ventrally. If you remember the cranial folding of the primitive embryonic disc, this corresponds to the cranial fold ventrally. Okay, so this is called the cervical flexure. Why this is called cervical flexure? Because this is cervical part of the spinal cord. So the rhombencephalon bends onto the spinal cord, okay, ventrally like this. Now, if you look at the other two vesicles, at the midbrain, the brain again bends, and this is called the mesencephalic flexure. So you have two of these flexures within the brain, and it's not just lying like this. Similarly, if you look at a lateral view of the five vesicle stage, it's like this. Okay, so let us contrast what is happening here and what is happening over here. This was the initial cervical flexure, and this was the mesencephalic flexure. Between that, you had the rhombencephalon. The rhombencephalon is now bending on itself, but this bend is slightly different. This bend was ventral, but this bend is dorsally directed. The concavity of this bend is dorsally directed. This flexure is called the pontine flexure. Okay, so you have a metencephalon here and the myelencephalon here. And from the metencephalon backwards, you have something called the rhombic lip, from where you develop the cerebellum. Thus, the cerebellum will be somewhat hanging like this, okay, but posteriorly directed. Now, let us look at how these, how the prosencephalon that was located like this differentiates into these two. You have a midline diencephalon, and this is the enlarging telencephalic vesicle. You are seeing the right telencephalic vesicle. If you look at this picture, you have a left telencephalic vesicle on the other side of it. But these two become so enormous, and it sort of sandwiches the diencephalon between it. So as mentioned in the picture, you have three brain vesicles: the prosencephalon, the mesencephalon, and the rhombencephalon, and the spinal cord below it. So if I hold this like this in a lateral view, you have the spinal cord like this. It bends onto the hindbrain. Okay, this is the cervical flexure. So this is the hindbrain. Then it bends at the midbrain, okay, more ventrally, and then it forms the prosencephalon, or the forebrain. So between the mesencephalic flexure and the cervical flexure, you have the hindbrain. So if you imagine the hindbrain to be something like a thick stick, you imagine it to be a bamboo stick, and I'm going to hold it and I'm going to bend it like this backwards. Okay, I mentioned that the pontine flexure has its concavity dorsally. So if I hold this stick and if I bend it like this, imagine the roof will break and the boundaries will become somewhat rhombic. That is the reason why the hindbrain was called rhombencephalon. So the roof of this will break. The metencephalon and the myelencephalon forms a floor, and the roof is broken. And from this rhombic shaped brain, that is called the hindbrain, from the lips of the metencephalon, you have the formation of the rhombic lip, and that forms the cerebellum. This is the reason why metencephalon forms pons in front and cerebellum behind, and the myelencephalon forms the medulla oblongata. Now let us look into the formations of what are the peculiarities that is going to occur in the prosencephalon. If I take the prosencephalon back, if I take this entire brain back like this in this orientation, you have the prosencephalon, which derives into two large telencephalic vesicles and a midline diencephalon. Initially, these are separate, but the telencephalon grows enormously large. It is initially a small bubble, then it becomes enormously large, that the medial surface of the telencephalon comes and adheres to the diencephalon. Okay, so and the diencephalon is somewhat
sandwiched between and amalgamates with the telencephalic vesicles. So after this phase, if you want to see the diencephalon, it will become very much difficult in the intact brain. You will have to see the diencephalon either by cutting the brain like this or cutting the brain like this, because the diencephalon is now sandwiched between the two telencephalic vesicles.
Now let us look at these terms in the mature brain, how we can identify each of these parts in the mature brain. This is a diagram showing a midline sagittal image, and we'll understand this with the color codes. This is the medulla oblongata. Below you have the spinal cord, not shown here, and above you have the metencephalon. If you look at this diagram, the metencephalon containing the pons in front and the cerebellum behind, and cranial to that you have the mesencephalon, which is the midbrain. So this is the midbrain, so this is the pons, this is cerebellum, and this is the midbrain. Above that, cranial to that, you have the diencephalon, okay, which is shown in this blue color. The diencephalon, as I mentioned many times, denotes something that has the word thalamus in it. So what you see here is the thalamus. Okay, this is the thalamus. You are not seeing the entire view of the thalamus here, but this is the medial surface of the left thalamus. This part is the hypothalamus, and this is the epithalamus. We'll come to the details of this later, but this is just an overview. So this part you will call it as the diencephalon. And this enormous part is the telencephalic vesicle. As I mentioned, this is the most gigantic vesicles of all this brain vesicles. So let us review once more. The myelencephalon, which is the medulla oblongata, the pons and the cerebellum, which is the metencephalon, the mesencephalon, which is the midbrain, the thalamus, hypothalamus, and the epithalamus, together called the diencephalon, and the large telencephalon, which is the cerebrum, its white matter, everything. Right, now we are seeing the brain from the ventral aspect. If you look at this picture, if I take the brain and view from here, okay, this is the ventral aspect of the brain. We'll again do the same exercise. This is the medulla oblongata. Above that, cranial to that, you have the metencephalon containing the pons and the cerebellum behind. Above that, you have the midbrain. The midbrain is over here. It's not very clearly seen in this picture. Above that, you have the diencephalon. This is the lower part of the diencephalon, the only part of the diencephalon that you can see in the intact brain. And you have two enormous telencephalic vesicles. This is the gross anatomy specimen, which again shows the medulla oblongata. This is the pons. This is the cerebellum, which is the metencephalon. You have the midbrain over here. This is the diencephalon. Okay, this picture clearly shows diencephalon. This is the hypothalamus. This is the thalamus, somewhat egg-shaped. Okay, and this is the epithalamus, which contains an important gland here. This is the pineal gland. So this region is the diencephalon, and this is the enormous telencephalon. If we look at the ventral view again, this is the medulla oblongata. This is the pons and the cerebellum. These two structures that you see, which are called the cerebral peduncles, these are actually the ventral aspect of the midbrain. Okay, and above that, these two are the mammillary bodies, and this is the pituitary stalk, and this will be the hypothalamus. The only part of the hypothalamus, the part of the diencephalon that you can see. Okay, this corresponds to this thing. This is the mammillary body, and this is the pituitary stalk. So these are the parts that you are seeing here over here. Above that, you can see the cranial to that, you can see the enormous telencephalic vesicle. Now, I mentioned only an overview of the brain, but I want you to understand one important terminology that is important in an overview class of the neuroanatomy, that is a brainstem, which I didn't mention till now. The brainstem contains three structures. One is the medulla oblongata. Above that, you have the pons, and above that, you have the midbrain. So you can see that these three things are almost stacked upon each other, the medulla, the pons, and the midbrain. And these three are together called brainstem. It is very important to note that it excludes the cerebellum. So I'll put a formula somewhat like this. The brainstem is equal to the midbrain plus the hindbrain minus the cerebellum, right? The minus the cerebellum. So why is brainstem so important? Brainstem contains a lot of important structures. For example, you have the cranial nerve nuclei of the 3rd to the 12th cranial nerves. It contains a lot of ascending and descending tracts, a lot of nuclei that are important for cerebellar circuitry. And it also contains the reticular formation within its core that contains some of the vital structures. Example, in the medulla, it contains vital cardiorespiratory centers. And so it becomes a very important area in neuroanatomy. Thank you.